Professor Rajan, one of China's big efforts has been the Belt and Road Initiative. They say that it's not anything but an economic effort at reaching out to countries ultimately all over the world, but certainly initially in Asia. Be that as it may, India, for example, has lots of problems with that. We believe that it affects our sovereignty because of where the road physically lies or goes through what we call Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. These divergent views exist. So how exactly does one, for example, the world's largest democracy, India, and a country like China, overcome these? Because both have nationalist interests.
Right. Look, I think the emergence of populism in the West creates an opportunity because we are moving to a multipolar world, at least economically. And certainly, you know, from the perspective of defense, the U.S. is still the by far and large the strongest army and defense forces in the world. But China is catching up, and of course, in the as far as numbers go, there are other countries that are closing in. The broader point is that the world was made with the United States at its center post-World War II. The allies came together and created multilateral institutions, which would essentially give the U.S. veto power. But the U.S. was accepted because, in a sense, it was the largest and the most powerful country in the world, but also it rarely exercised that power. Mm. It was a very benign hegemony, if you will. And these organizations flourished. We got global trade. The rise of China, in part, was facilitated by the United States. Mm-hmm. The problem today, however, is that we still have those institutional structures, but we haven't adapted for the fact that now there are a number of countries knocking on the door. And we have to have a new rules-based system, which doesn't necessarily give the U.S. that central power, but acknowledges that Europe is big, the U.S. is big, China is big, eventually India and Brazil will also be big players. And their role has to be recognized in these institutions. Now, in fact, we've got the opposite. We have the U.S., as you said, backing off, but unwilling to relinquish its hold over these institutions. Mm-hmm. In fact, what we've seen with the World Bank presidency opening up is they want to put a U.S. person, regardless, even though there is no strong belief in multilateralism in this administration. And that's to my mind, playing into this situation where China says, okay, if they won't let us in, we're going to create our own separate structures. And we're going to challenge the existing structures by working outside. And there is already talk that the Asian Investment Bank that that China has created actually rolls out loans faster and in a more effective way than the ADB or the World Bank. And so, my mind, if we don't have a change in these, we will get more of the world that China makes.
Right. And but talk about Belt and Road, if you will, because it's a huge initiative. Well, it's problematic at so many levels.
Well, it is. It has so many objectives. It has so many sides to it. If you see it from the perspective of some of the countries for which they've had successful projects financed, China's providing finance that's not available elsewhere. If you see it from the perspective of Sri Lanka, which gives up its port, or Pakistan, which today a number of Pakistanis feel aggrieved that there's so much sort of Pakistani debt for projects that seem to be privileged to the Chinese. I think the Chinese certainly are trying to expand both the economic influence as well as to some extent the political influence. But I think it would be better for them and for the world if this was done in a more multilateral setting. And the problem with the Belt and Road is right now it's been seen, you know, for whatever the changes, it's been seen as a Chinese initiative. It was seen as more a multilateral initiative. It would benefit them. That requires cooperation from the West. It requires a recalculation of the institutions.